And Bienvenidos, worldwide fans of cinema. For the first time in 2016, you got the return of Enfuegotainment with yours truly. I'm Ian Fuego and my co-host.
I'm Cecil Laird. What up? Yes. New year, new fun.
I know. And there are so many awesome movies coming out here in the year of 2016, from another Star Wars movie to we've got superheroes galore. It's going to be rad. But we're starting it out with a film that came out right before the end of the year. Christmas Day was when it got its wide release. It was in Limited before that. But the new Tarantino, man, we got some Hateful Eight coming at you guys.
Okay, everybody. Hear this. I'm taking this woman to hang. Rewards $10,000. That money's mine, boys.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Hold on!
You think I'll make a hoose with that fella or her?
That's my problem, boy. I don't know.
One of them fellas will kill everybody in here.
Now we're talking!
Let's slow it down. Let's slow it way down.
Absolutely. This one was interesting, I think. I think this review, I don't know. I don't know how this review is going to go. I'll be interested to see your opinion. So.
Yeah, the exhaustion in our faces is not just because it's late, but first and foremost that this movie is 3 hours. Now, Tarantino's often taken his time, Pulp Fiction clocked in at around 2.5, if I remember, right?
Maybe 220, something like that. Yeah.
Django 2.
Yeah, this one was 248, and I felt every minute of it.
Especially at the beginning. But I guess maybe we can save that for, you know, the malo.
The
bad portion. So we're going to jump right into the bueno, the malo, the feo, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And that trope is kind of pertinent here because this is a Western, right?
Yep. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it was a Western, you know, as far as clothing and speech goes.
Well, not all the speech, and I'll save that for my wallet. Some good stuff, though, man. I mean, first and foremost, we got the second, I'd say the third period piece in a row that he's done, and the second straight Western after Django, which I at least think was a superior movie to this.
I did too, in
a lot of ways. I mean, Christoph Waltz was incredible, but we still, a bueno for me is going to be the cast. The casting in this Western, I mean, you have some really heavy hitters. Kurt Russell doing another Western after seeing Bone Tomahawk at the end of 2015. Fantastic film. One of my favorite horror films. We do the horror show stuff together, and that was on my top six of the year. So it's nice to see Russell doing a little bit more Western action, but there's a whole lot of other guys in there. Who's the other gang in this?
You had Tim Roth. You had Michael Madsen. You had Samuel L. Jackson, of course.
Yeah, he's in just about every Tarantino movie he can get into. So.
Jennifer Jason Leigh. You had Zoe Bell show up, another Tarantino alum. There was quite a pedigree of actors in the film. And Channing Tatum even shows up in a sort of surprising role.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Who was your favorite? Who do you think did the best job?
Samuel L. Jackson, I think.
Really?
I'd have a hard time saying anyone else because he kind of, I mean, the movie starts with him and he,
it does,
you know, he is a pivotal character throughout the whole movie. He kind of grounds the whole thing. He's sort of like the Hercule Poirot of the story. He's the detective, as it were, trying to piece things together and figure stuff out.
Yeah, because this is a mystery, and that's another point that I can jump onto maybe is the fact that I thought the concept at least was really cool. Execution might have been lacking at certain times, but you know, I like the bueno similarity to his very first film, Reservoir Dogs. Very self-contained, and you know, you're not sure of everyone's agendas, and there's deception involved. It's just, you know, in the post-Civil War, very cold state of Wyoming, right? Mm-hmm. Where big old blizzard comes in, and so Samuel L. Jackson's character, after seeking refuge with Kurt Russell's carriage and this prisoner that he's carrying, she's another bueno for me, but we can get to her in a moment. They end up stowing away in this cabin, which is en route to Red Rock, where they're heading, and supposed to deliver this prisoner, who's Jennifer Jason Leigh, man, and her performance was a standout for me. What'd you think?
Yeah, she was really good in this one. I thought she was a little over the top towards the end.
And that'd be a little malo for me.
Yeah.
We'll get to it.
Yeah, especially when they had to affect her physically in a particular way that was super distracting for the entire rest of the movie for me.
Oh, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
So, yeah. She was good up until then, the weirdness that she was exuding and she obviously knew more than she was letting on and stuff like that, which
so do sense. Many people in this movie though.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. But the first point I wanted to mention specifically was the you know me, again, you mentioned we do the horror show together.
Yeah.
So my first bueno is going to be the gore involved. Because there
I
was,
should have known you were going to
yeah,
say that.
There was two extremely surprising bits of gore. There was a lot of, there was more gore than that, but there was two really surprising bits that were really awesome and caught me off guard both times. And I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. Yeah, step it up a notch, I guess, you know. So yeah, that was really good as a horror fan, and you know, action movies have good gore in them too, if they're done right. So you know, with the very small amount of action that we actually got in
this
movie.
Yeah, and that's why I would say it was more like a crime drama perhaps than an actual you know, like full on action.
It was a murder mystery. It was like ten little Indians or 12 little Indians. So, yeah. Like I said, it's a Poirot mystery. It's who done it, you know, and that's really,
and that was an intriguing angle. So that was a bueno that I wanted to nail home. Some of the performances were better than others, but as a whole, cool concept, beautifully shot because it's Tarantino.
Beautifully shot.
Lots of interesting angles of characters talking down into the camera.
In retrospect, we did not see it in the 70mm. In retrospect, I kind of wish we had because there were a couple of camera techniques that they had to use in order to get around the fact that we weren't seeing nearly as big a picture as normally you would see in a 70mm movie.
And that was a malo that I was going to mention. Did you have any other buenos, any other good bits to toss down before we start like wrecking into it?
You know what? Kurt Russell, always a bueno for me. I mean, you already mentioned the acting. But, you know, I would say structure because usually I love Tarantino's structure, but I thought the pacing was oof.
And that ties in with, I guess, one of the first, you know, models that we can mention is the pacing. You can sometimes see a film that clocks in over 2.5 hours, and it doesn't feel like that amount of time.
Oh, yeah.
This one most definitely did because it was very plodding, and, I mean, it was just kind of setting all of its chess pieces in play. And it was about as slow as a chess game, too, which you see in the movie.
Oh,
so,
my God.
Encompassed it.
It starts with one guy getting picked up in the snow, and there's a big conversation whether they should get picked up. And you're like, okay, yeah, I kind of expected that from the trailer.
Yeah.
And then it happens again. And you're like, okay, really? And then they make it to the thing, and Kurt Russell's going around saying the exact same thing to character after character, and you're like, okay.
You're like, come on, Tarantino.
Let's move it along, man. Move it along.
Once it got there, it was good, but it was just too methodical and just kind of slow burn at the beginning. And I mean, sometimes that works well, and others, it just really depends on the director and the film itself. I mean, it felt like its length. And also that whole 70mm thing that you mentioned, man, I am kind of wishing, because it was almost like we were watching the standard like television.
Yeah, it's like the old pan and scan versus widescreen.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's weird, you know, when having watched movies as long as I have, I could tell the parts, you know, or a lot of the parts where that was going on, and I'm like,
we're being denied the letterboxed edition or widescreen or whatever they
I'm not a fan of being denied that stuff. I want to see everything that's shot, you know. So you know, next time this happens with a movie, if anyone does this experiment again, I'll definitely see it right. I kind of knew.
What, Interstellar were the last to do 70mm?
Did Interstellar do that? I didn't see that in the theater either. That was my fault also. Yeah. But, you know, the shots at the very beginning of the movie, it was almost very anti-Tarantino, the amount of landscape shots that he did at the very beginning of the movie, which was interesting. I'm like, oh, okay, he's doing something different. And then I'm like, oh, that's right, it's the 70mm thing, so he's showing off the landscapes. Like, oh, okay, that's right. So the pacing, as you said, and as I mentioned earlier, very rough. The character development took way too long. The other malo I wanted to mention that tied into what I was saying earlier is usually I'm a big fan of Tarantino's structure. He shuffles things around a lot of times.
He kind of did it in this,
but he took so long before he did it. Here's the thing. I was ready for the movie to be over by the time he finally shifted and told the story that happened previous. Okay. I was like, oh no, we're doing this now? That means we've got at least like 45 minutes left.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, I felt every minute of this movie, and it's such a shame because Tarantino usually has stuff that breaks up the monotony.
Yeah.
But there was just, because it was more murder mystery, there just wasn't a lot of that going on. I was praying for surprise shootings, and I got one or two, but not enough.
Yeah, the action eventually came, and you know, there was odd dialogue between the action and building up to all of it. I mean, some of it I bought into it, but it had just, for being a period piece, it had much more of a modern type feel to a lot of, you know, everything that the characters were saying, and it kind of just brought me out of the film a little bit, which was kind of irksome. And then also the music didn't always work for me. It was about 50-50. Like there's some music during the scenes when they were showing the landscapes and stuff that I was just like, this is too cheesy. Like, what type of mood are they going for?
Now we're talking.
I mean, and there's only really two musical bits that I thought were very effective. And yeah, those bits were where one particular character grabs a guitar and starts strumming along. And lastly, the ending music I thought was really, really effective too.
Yeah, you know, it was interesting to me. Tarantino had some limitations in this one because it was a period piece. He had similar limitations with Inglourious Basterds, same with Django.
Yeah.
But it felt weird. He didn't have all those, you know, pop culture references to lean on, and he didn't seem to play as much hand-selected music as he normally does that usually augments his movies so much.
Because he didn't have the ability.
Yeah, you know? So I felt those absences, unfortunately.
Yeah. And music, as we know, can help drive something forward a little bit better than just like a really slow score. And so, I mean, yeah, so that was another thing for me. And Malo, yeah, beyond that, I'm not sure. I guess I'm anxious to get into the Feo and talk about the one ugly thing that I've been awaiting to mention.
Okay, go ahead. You go first, because I have something too, and I wonder if it's the same.
It just might be. The whole production of this film had some big-time setbacks.
Different.
That's okay. Good then. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to mention the fact that, remember, this script for this film leaked. And Tarantino threw a big fit, and it was an ugly situation. He, like, canceled production of the film, I guess it was still in pre-production at that time. But, yeah, he was like, I'm not even going to do it now. And then he apparently did some mild alterations to the script and then was like, okay, I guess I am going to make it now. And so I'm not sure if it was all the original actors. I know Tim Roth was at one of those readings where one of the, like, it was an actor that leaked the original script.
It was the older one, I believe, the one that played the general.
Madsen.
Yeah.
And he's an old Tarantino homie going all the way back to Reservoir Dogs.
No, not Madsen, the older gentleman.
Oh, the guy who was the general.
Yeah, the general.
Okay. Interesting.
So it was probably just a mistaken technology thing. Like,
yeah.
Didn't know.
Who knows, but it set everything back, and it makes me kind of wonder if they
What was the original?
It's kind of ugly, you know? Like, if all those troubles hadn't gone down, what kind of film would we be seeing?
Would we have seen a stronger one? I think we probably would have.
I'm hoping. But, you know, at this point, it doesn't really matter. So.
Yeah.
So what's your fail, man? Now I'm all
My
curious.
My fail is... So we're watching this movie, it's a Western, and we're into the characters, and Tarantino takes us out of the film a little bit when he throws in chapter headings. There's about five chapter headings throughout the movie.
Goodness, where he's talking.
And well, thank you for ruining it. He brings us further out of the movie when he decides, after one of those chapter ends, that he's gonna update us on what's been going on, even though we've just sat through what's been going on. Like, he's just narrating stuff that's just happened as though we had a full intermission or something like that.
And that actually makes... I had heard that this film does have an intermission at certain places.
I heard the 70mm one does, yeah.
And so I'm guessing that's what we had to deal with.
I guess, but who cares? Even
why didn't it break
minutes,
it up so I could have gone and got another iced tea or something?
Well, even 15 minutes... Yeah, I actually finished my water, and that never happens when I'm engrossed in a movie. But why do that? Even with a 15-minute intermission... Why would he need to remind everyone what's been going on? I mean, that's not that long. We're not dumb. And hearing the director's voice...
Short-term memory.
Hearing the director's voice jump in, though, it pulled me immediately out of the movie. And I was like, I couldn't even focus on what was going on. I'm like, come on. Yeah, that was frustrating. That was big-time fail for me.
Yeah, so there was definitely a lot of less than bueno bits in this film as a whole. I guess I was expecting a little bit more from Tarantino. It was, I mean, to bring things full circle... When it was violent, it was good, and I felt like it ended kind of cathartically without giving too much away. And I mean, the carnage finally came, and it kind of redeemed itself for me. But up until that point, the last maybe quarter of the film, it was definitely lacking, at least for me.
It's funny. as little action as there was, it still felt the most like Reservoir Dogs of any of his movies.
Oh, yeah.
The whole way through. All the way down to some very similar character beats, which I won't ruin.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
But to
even a certain character dynamic that eventually kind of
Yeah, that's created. True. That's actually true. Yep, I didn't see that either. So if that intrigues you, then go check it out. But just expect lots of talking, lots of dialogue.
I also have one more fail to mention before we sign off, and that's one character that can't seem to survive a Western.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of unfortunate.
It
is unfortunate. We're not going to reveal who, but
no, that's
probably because he's so damn good in them.
Yeah. He's got to go out in a blaze of glory every time.
Truth be told. Well, this was a blaze of bloody in this one.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
That was one of the best scenes in the movie,
He's gone out in a blaze of bloody in a few different ways recently.
Yeah, actually, the other way was better than this one. Far more effective.
Yeah.
Hey, nonetheless, it is Tarantino. Mm-hmm. It's one of those watershed moments in film. He makes a film every, 2-3 years?
Yeah.
Something like that. So it's almost just kind of a given if you've liked any of his previous movies. At least check this out. Be your own judge of it. But for us, it was not,
lackluster, unfortunately.
Yeah, it was just okay. Mm-hmm. So in any event, I can extend a grande gracias. Cecil Laird, my homeboy here, my partner in, co-host in crime. And what's the project that we do together so we can let the audiences know?
That would be the horror show. It's youtube.com/thehorrorshowchannel or thehorrorshowchannel.com. We do horror movie reviews, how-tos, comedy sketches, celebrity interviews. In fact, this guy just got to interview the zombie godfather, George Romero. So check that out. That was a great interview. Con coverage, all kinds of good stuff, you guys. We're a true horror variety show, and we do podcasts every single week. Over 320 video episodes, over 90 podcasts, so tons of content for you guys. Check it out.
Yeah, loads of fun, tons of stuff to check out for free, which is the best part of all. And I'm Jaime Enfuego. You can link up with me on all social media sectors, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, obviously here on YouTube too. So once again, gracias. It was real. It always is with Tarantino, even if it's not that realistic. So in any event, until we talk a little bit more cinema with you guys soon, adios.
Later. We'll be right back.